मुंबई। आई एम सोनाली शंकराव कांबळे फ्रॉम वर्षानगर मुंबई पब्लिक स्कूल एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टीच हिस्ट्री सब्जेक्ट एंड आवर टॉपिक इज एंशियंट इंडिया एंड द वर्ल्ड। सो लेट्स बिगिन। Before to teach, I would like to say some objectives of this lesson. First one, from this lesson, each students will know the history of ancient India. Second one, to know the trade relation of India and the countries of the West. Third one, to understand the Harappan civilization. Fourth one, to know about expansion of Buddhism. And the fifth one, to analyze values and thoughts of ancient period. Before to teach, I would like to ask some previous questions based on the map. This is our map, and from this peak, I'm going to ask few questions. So my first question is, what is the capital of India? Yes. Yes, anyone?
Delhi.
Delhi, correct. Very good. The capital of our India is the Delhi, New Delhi. Correct. The second question, which countries are in the east side of India? I repeat my question. Which countries are in the east side of India? From this map, you can observe it and tell me the name of that countries which are in the east side of India. Yes? Anyone? Observe the map and then tell the answers.
Maharashtra.
Beta, Maharashtra is not the country, it's a state.
Bangladesh.
Where, which one? Bangal Bay. Tell me the name of country.
Delhi.
Yes? Delhi is also the state. Yes.
Bay of Bengal.
Of the countries which are the, in the east side is Nepal. Here, Nepal. You can see Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh are the countries of the east side of India. Okay, like that, there is a some countries are also present on the in the west side of India. For example, yes. Third question is that. Which countries are in the west side of India? India is present and shaded in that color. And after that, which are the country are in the west
New side Delhi.
Of India? For example, Iran, Afghanistan are present west side of India. In today's topic also, we are going to learn about the countries of the west side of India and also the trade relation of India with countries of west side. Okay. So before going to start to teach my lesson, I would like to share a video of on this lesson. So listen it carefully.
Ancient India and the world. India and the countries of the West. People of the Harappan civilization had developed trade relations with the countries of the West. Ever since then, India has had economic and cultural exchanges with the outside world. Buddhism had spread to Afghanistan and to many countries of Central Asia. During the period of the Iranian Empire, India's contact with the Western world increased. The Greek historians of that period grew more curious about India. Their writings introduced India to the Western world. The routes which were later used by Alexander were open for trade between India and the countries of the West. Under the influence of the Greek art of sculpture, a new form of art emerged in India during the Kushana period. It is called Gandhara School of Art. In the Gandhara Art School, images of Gautam Buddha were mainly carved. As these images were mostly found in the Gandhara region of Afghanistan, the style is called the Gandhara style. The facial features of the statues made in this style are similar to those of the Greek people. The early coins that were minted in India were also like Greek coins. Around the 1st or 2nd century CE, trade between India and Rome flourished. The ports in South India also had a large share in this trade. Some articles made of bronze were found in the excavations at Kolhapur. They have been made in Rome. The excavations at Arikamedu in Tamil Nadu have also brought to light many articles made in Rome. Both these places were important centers of trade between India and Rome. Many such trade centers are mentioned in the literature of those times. Alexandria was an important port in Egypt. The Arab merchants carried Indian goods to Alexandria. They were sent to the countries in Europe. Besides Indian goods, the Arabs also conveyed Indian philosophy and science to Europe. The concept of zero is one of India's major contributions to the world. It was the Arabs who introduced this Indian concept to Europe. India and other countries.
Yes. From this video, there are few concepts are given. For example, first one is the Harappa civilization. Then the video also tell us about the how the spread of Buddhism is done. After that, we are going to learn about the Alexander and the Alexandria port also. And again, there is a main concept is given, that is Kushana period. So we are going to learn each concepts in details. So first one is the Harappan civilization. The Indus Valley civilization is also known as the Harappan civilization. Indus is the name of a river, and the Indus Valley civilization, also known as Harappan civilization. In this peaks, you can see the village of Harappa. Harappa is 4,700 years old city in the subcontinent discovered in 1920. It means that Harappa is 4,700 years old city, which was discovered in 1920. After its discovery, cities like Mohenjo-daro, Lothal, Dholavira, and Kalibanga have also been discovered and are known as the Harappan cities, as were discovered after Harappa. All these cities were discovered around River Indus and hence prove the existence of the Indus Valley civilization. These four cities, for example, Mohenjo-daro, Lothal, Dholavira, and the Kalibanga, are the four cities are discovered around River Indus. That's why they are known as the Indus Valley civilization. Harappa civilization had developed trade relations with the countries of West. See, in this map, what is given? The green shaded part shows the Harappa cities. For example, Mohenjo-daro city, Lothal city, again Kalibanga, and the other also. And these are all cities are discovered nearby Indus River. Here, Indus also given name is also mentioned. Name is mentioned for the river. Harappans created sculptures, seals, pottery, and the jewelry from materials such as terracotta, metal, and the stones. Here, what is given? Seals. Seal is word is given. The meaning of this word is it's a device which referred to impression in paper, wax, or any other clay or any other medium. In the second picture, everyone can see about the pottery. Different kinds of pottery is given, and the third one is also there is some metals are shown in that peak which are made by terracotta. So the area of Harappan civilization extended along the Indus River. I show a map also. That Indus River today, that Indus River and that portion is known, or that portion is we know as the Afghanistan into Pakistan also. It means that Harappan civilization, that portion is nowadays are present in the Afghanistan and the Pakistan. There is a short video on the Harappan civilization where all the parts are given about the Harappa civilization. Let's see it.
Human history is replete with the accounts of rise and fall of civilizations and empires. Human settlements first began on the banks of the fertile river plains in four different parts of the world. These river valleys began the cradle of human civilization. Mesopotamian civilization flourished on the banks of River Tigris and Euphrates. Egyptian civilization flourished on the banks of the River Nile. Chinese civilization on the rivers of Huanghe, and Harappa civilization flourished on the banks of the River Indus and its tributaries. Of these ancient civilizations, Harappa civilization holds extreme merits due to its outstanding town planning. This feature was not found in any of the contemporary civilization. Glimpse of the civilization and its outstanding town planning can be seen at the site of Mohenjo-daro. The cities of Harappa civilization were essentially divided into two parts, except Dholavira, which had three. The part which was towards the west was higher, built on a raised hill and known as the citadel. The other part, which was on the east, was called the lower town and was of a lesser height. The citadel was a prominent mound surrounded by fortified walls. It was the nerve center of the city. A huge tank called the Great Bath was constructed for water. Made of plaster and natural tar, it was probably used for bathing purpose by the rulers and had steps on both sides leading down to the water. The lower town was the residential area where the common folk lived. It was a thriving economic and cultural center. The houses were single or double-storied, whereas the streets were laid out in a grid-like pattern, intersecting each other at right angles. Houses opened onto smaller lanes on the outside and courtyards on the inside. Within the houses, separate rooms were made for different activities. Some rooms appear to have been set aside for bathing. Wastewater from the bathroom was directed to the drains which lined the inner streets. Larger drains on the main street assisted the flow of water towards the outskirts of the city. This proved the existence of well-planned drainage system. The city received its water supply from large public wells. This provided water for bathing and washing purposes for the citizens. As it is with everything, these Indus Valley cities too started showing signs of decay and decline. Floods, overcrowding, lack of control by rulers, and indifferent maintenance could be the reason for this great civilization's inability to retain its glory and slowly declined. Ironically, human history is repeated with such pattern of growth and decay, and is well articulated in Shelley's famous poem, Ozymandias. To quote the last line from it, "My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look upon my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare. The lone and level stands stretch far away."
So from this video, we have learned that how was the Mohenjo-daro city, and how their houses are built up in that period, and also we learn about the drainage system of that period, which was present in the Mohenjo-daro city. From this video, we have a short concept on the Harappa civilization. So next, we are going to learn about the Gautam Buddha. In our previous lecture also, I have shown a video on the Gautam Buddha, and I also teach you about the Gautam Buddha and their thoughts and their whole life journey. First one, Buddhism was founded by Gautam Buddha. We all know that Buddhism was founded by Gautam Buddha. After that, Gautam Buddha was born as Prince Siddhartha at Lumbini near Kapilvastu, where nowadays Kapilvastu is present in Nepal. He gave his first sermon at Sarnath near Varanasi. The term Buddha means enlightened one. So Gautam Buddha gave his first sermon. The word sermon, it means that speech on religious or moral subject, which was given at Sarnath near Varanasi. The term Buddha, here Buddha means what? The Buddha means enlightened one. Enlightened means the person or the Buddha who knows about the truth, about truth of existence. Buddha wandered for 7 years and at the age of 35 attained enlightenment at Uruvela while meditating under a peepal tree on the banks of the river Niranjana. This tree came to known as Bodhi tree, and the place became Bodha Gaya. Here one name of place is given, that is Uruvela. It's a place where Gautam Buddha is said to have attained enlightenment under what become known as Bodhi tree. Nowadays the Bodhi tree is at Gaya district in the Indian state of Bihar. When Gautam Buddha passed away around 483 BC, his followers began to organize a religious movement. After the Gautam Buddha, followers spread Buddhism or spread the thoughts of the Buddha to among all peoples by organizing a different kinds of religious movements. Buddha's teaching became the foundation for what would develop into Buddhism. In the 3rd century BC, the Ashoka the Great, the Maurya and Indian emperor, made Buddhism the state religion of India. To spread of Buddhism, there is a most valuable contribution given by the Ashoka, the king of the Maurya Empire, and he made Buddhism the state religion of India also. Buddhism had spread to Afghanistan and to many countries in Asia. See, in this peak, everyone can see about how Buddhism spread through Asia. The Ashoka Empire gives more contribution to spread of the Buddhism from India to various other countries. See, the rounded circle shows our India country, and the arrow shows the spread of Buddhism from India to other countries. Here, first one is given, for example, India to Afghanistan. After that, India to Korea, then Japan also, then India to Sri Lanka, and the Sri Lanka to Indonesia. The arrow shows the spread of Buddhism from India to other countries of our Asia. Now let's see about the Kushana Empire. Kushanas are considered to be one of the five branches of the Yuazhi tribe lived in the Chinese frontier or Central Asia. Kushanas empires are one of the five branches of the Chinese frontier or Chinese ancient period. Sanskrit literature began to be developed during this time. The fourth Buddhist council was held in Sanskrit. We all know that the Buddhist literature and the Buddhist council are given in the Pali language, but in the Kushana Empire, what happened? The Buddhist council was also held in the Sanskrit language. During this time, the distinct school of art flourished as Gandhara school in Northeast India. During the Kushana Empire, there is a new art is discovered that known as Gandhara school of art. Trade prospered between India and China and India and the Roman empires. The Kushanas controlled large parts of the Silk Route, which led to the propagation of Buddhism into China. It shows that Kushanas, what have done, they spread Buddhism into the China through Silk Road. Silk Road is a way of trade. It means that from the Silk Road, the India and the China was connected to do trade, and from this way they are spreading Buddhism into the China also. It was during this time that Buddhism began to spread Korea and Japan also. Because of the trade only, the Buddhism is also spread to the Korea and Japan also. It is said that Kushana period in history was a perfect forerunner to the golden age of the Guptas. See, the red market marked line shows us about the Silk Route. The Silk Route used for the trade purposes to connect the different kinds of countries for a trade purpose. And from this map, you have learned about the expansion of the Kushana Empire. The green shaded part shows the Kushana Empire. Just now I told about that Gandhara art was discovered in the Kushana Empire. So let's see what is the Gandhara art. In this school of art, the life size statues of Gautam Buddha were carved. Until then, the Buddhist existence was shown in the form of symbols like lotus, umbrella, etc. In this school, what is given? The statues of Gautam Buddha were carved, and different in the different kinds of form also. For example, lotus and the umbrella. Gandhara art emerged in India during the Kushana period. We must remember that Gandhara art emerged in Kushana periods. Let's see the various mudras of Buddha in the Gandhara art. In the Buddha depicted in the Gandhara art is shown making four types of head gesture, and this is remarkable feature in this art. There are four types of gesture or four types of mudras of Buddha is given in the Gandhara art. So first one is the Abhay Mudra. Abhay Mudra means don't fear. We should not fear from anyone. The first picture of Gautam Buddha shows the Abhay Mudra. Second one, Dhyana Mudra. It means the meditation. In the second peak, we are going to see about the Gautam Buddha's positions, that is Dhyana Mudra. Third one, Dharma Chakra Mudra. In the third one position, what is given? Preaching Mudra. It means giving a knowledge or giving a thoughts or lessons to others. And the fourth one, Bhumi Sparsha Mudra. It shows the touching the earth. This kind of four types of gesture of Buddha was discovered or shown by the Gandhara school of art. Polishing the statues is an important feature of this art also. The specimens were mostly prepared in stones, terracotta and the clay. Here the three kinds of arts are shown in the peak. The first one, Gandhara art, which is mainly in Buddhist. Second one, Mathura, and the third one is the Amravati. There are differences are given in the statue of Buddha. Now see, let's see about the next point, that is Alexandria. Alexandria was an important port in Egypt. Alexandria was an important port in Egypt, where Arab merchants carried Indian goods up to Alexandria. Port, Arab merchants carried Indian goods to Alexandria. The concept of zero is one of the India's major contribution to the world. Arabs introduced this Indian concept to Europe. We all know that the zero concept was given in India by Aryabhatta, and this contributions of is one of the major contribution of our India to the world. And the Arabs introduced this concept of Indian concept to Europe also. This is the Alexandria port, where the Indian goods will be exported to other countries. Here, the one name is given, that is Alexander. Alexander opened trade between India and the countries of the West. The King Alexander, he opened trade between the India and other countries also. He was one of the best military leaders of all time. He was famous for his bravery and his military works. He was born in 356 BC in Pella, the ancient capital of Macedonia. The Alexander the Great the name was name was Alexander. Is that Alexander the Great? Why the Great? Because Alexander was called Great because he was a skilled soldier and commander who was able to conquer many nations. That's why he was called as the Great Alexander. So now let's see what are the recapitulations. I give a brief knowledge about the main concepts of Harappa civilization, then the spread of Buddhism, then Kushana empires, and again the last one is the Alexandria. And now I'm going to ask some questions on these four concepts. Let's see. First question: Alexandria was an important port in, first one option is Egypt and the second one is the Iran. Tell me the correct option. That is, Alexandria was an important port in, yes,
Iran.
Iran? No,
Egypt.
Egypt, correct. Alexandria was an important port in Egypt. Very good. Let's see second question. The concept of blank is one of the India's major contribution to the world. The India's major contribution to the world. Option first is zero and the second one is one.
Zero.
Very good. Zero. Zero is the India's major contribution to the world. Very good. Question number third. Blank emerged in the Kushana period. What emerged in the Kushana period? First option, Gandhar art, or the second one, Greek art.
Gandhar art.
Yes, Gandhar art. Very good. That was emerged in the Kushana period. Very nice. The question number four, that is blank, was the founder of Buddhism. Who was the founder of Buddhism?
Gautama Buddha.
Very good. Before I am showing the options, all the students are giving answers. That is, Gautama Buddha was the founder of Buddhism. Very nice. Now let's see what are the assignments to all of you. First question, write down about the Gandhara style of art. Second one, write down about Alexandria port. Third one, write a note on Harappan civilization. Fourth one, write the thoughts and values of Buddhism. And the last one, study the map of India and the countries of the west side. So these are the five questions for the assignment, and I hope all the students understand today's lecture. Thank you.